Welcome to those who've just come in. It's good to have you here with us. Our scripture reading this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 53, verses 1 to 6. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. And he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed.
It brings me great joy to welcome to the Graduate School Chapel the Dean of the Graduate School, Scott Moreau. Scott has been a longtime friend and, I must say, a mentor. Just the other day, I had an intercultural question and Scott came up with an answer and he gave me a candy bar in addition to his wisdom. So I encourage you, if you haven't visited the Dean in his office, it could pay great dividends. Following his message, we're going to have a benediction, and it's going to be given by the acting chaplain of Wheaton College, Dr. Greg Waybright. And I want to thank Greg because something very special happened. Greg was the president of Trinity International University. He was the pastor of a very large church in Southern California, in Pasadena. But most importantly, he's a trustee at Wheaton College. And when we had trouble after COVID trying to reclaim Barrows Auditorium for the Graduate School Chapel, there were all sorts of other organizations who wanted to use it during our chapel slot. But thanks to Dr. Waybright, we were able to return to chapel, and it's wonderful to look out and see students, and we hope that we continue to have students joining us for chapel. And we won't give away chocolate bars, but we will have snacks. So thank you for listening online today, and we hope to see even more of you in person as the semester progresses. Scott, welcome back.
Thank you, Greg. It's good to be with you all again. I want to start with a simple question this morning. What do you imagine when you imagine Jesus? This first slide gives us a variety of artistic impressions of Christ from a variety of people. What did Jesus really look like? We don't have the answer to that question, but I invite you to imagine today what that might have been. Artist Sharon Cummings wonderfully captures my imagination with this image and this question. The question is the title of the image. Jesus Christ, how do you see me? Do you see me as darker skin and brown eyed? Do you see me as lighter skin and blue eyed? I invite you this morning to join me on a visual reconnaissance of images of Jesus. And I'm going to start with the most widely distributed image of Christ across the world, painted by native Chicagoan Warner Salmon. Well, studying at Moody, the dean asked him in a way I would never ask a student today. Sometime I hope you give us your conception of Christ. I would be happy to say that. I wouldn't be happy to say it this way, and I hope it's a manly one. Most of our pictures today of Christ are too effeminate. The blonde-haired, blue-eyed Jesus, you see, was the result. created in 1941, has been reproduced an estimated 500 million times. As a matter of fact, many soldiers carried this image in their pockets as a type of talisman of protection from enemy bullets at the time they went into battle. Most of you in the graduate school can connect with this serene yet strong Jesus made to look like me. But living in Africa for a decade as I did forced me to question my own comfort with Salmon's imagination. Forensic anthropologist Richard Neave reconstructed this striking image for BBC from skulls of first century Palestinian Jews living in the first century. He said, this is likely what an average Palestinian Jew looked like at the time. Perhaps this fits Isaiah's depiction, no form or comeliness that would be attracted to him, as opposed to Solomon's image. Solomon's image doesn't quite fit Isaiah's depiction the way the forensic anthropologist does. The third image was created for the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Finland, clearly playing off of Solomon's image but portraying Jesus as black. This was part of an ad campaign designed to attract a new audience to the church in Finland. Do you catch the irony? A secular ad firm, a Finnish church, and a black Christ. This illustrates the tension, if we go ahead and bring the slide back up. When we imagine Jesus, do we imagine the Christ of history, or do we portray him to make sense to us as the Christ of our faith? In theological circles, the historical Christ refers to early 20th century projects to recover what scholars referred to as the historical Christ. And they argued over biblical accounts. Did Jesus really say this? Did he really do this? That's not what I'm referring to here. What I'm referring to here is this first century Palestinian Jew. What did Jesus actually look like? As opposed to the Christ you and I picture in our imaginations of him. Given that February is Black History Month, it's appropriate for us this morning to explore Christ in black imagination. From Africa to the U.S., this collage illustrates the manifold ways that artists have imagined Jesus as black. I'm going to start with the center image in this collage. This is a marvelous painting by Mexican artist Father Fernando Arizzi. He ministered in the U.S. and Benin, West Africa, even though he was born in Mexico. He rightly argued that the U.S. community needs a Jesus with whom they could relate. The black community did. He depicts the incarnation in the historical framing of the African diaspora generated by the slave trade. He writes of this image. In the image on the left, we see a Zulu warrior and a princess both looking to the sky. To their right and down below are slaves on plantations in the deep south, also looking steadfastly to the sky. Continuing to the right are the descendants of slaves. Though their lives have changed since the civil rights movement, still today they are victims of prejudice in most levels of U.S. society. To the far right are the souls of the deceased ascending to God as the sun descends from God's hand. Arizzi writes, this is Emmanuel, God with us. This Mexican-born Jesuit priest clearly illustrates for us that black lives indeed matter to God. And that's one of the reasons I love this magnificent painting. Next week is Ash Wednesday. And as we walk toward Lent, in the rest of the images, I want to focus on events related to Easter. So this is all the complex of events from Gethsemane on through the trial and on through the crucifixion and resurrection. Life of Jesus Maffa is an innovative undertaking in the 1970s that was designed to help teach the gospel in northern Cameroon. French Catholic missionary Francois Vidal worked with the Maffa Christian communities in Cameroon to create a catalog of some 70 paintings depicting the life of Jesus in Maffa framing. To develop the project, Vidil formed a team of local church leaders, theologians, and a carefully selected artist. The team spent time in Maffa communities, reading Bible passages, and getting people to reenact these passages as they would in their daily lives. Vidil and his team would photograph their reenactments as the artists sketched them. These sketches and pictures became the basis for the final paintings in this collection. Their intention, successfully completed, was to build a resource that would help the Maffa of Cameroon teach from the Bible in the way that connects with their community. This is one of the images I happen to love the most, perhaps because I resonate with the little child down in the lower left running away. Doesn't that look like a Norman Rockwell type of image? There is that precociousness, panic, I've got to get out of here. But at the same time, the entire rest of the scene is very Maffa-like. An average day in the market, Jesus overturning what's taking place. Well, what happens when you can't identify yourself with the image of your Savior? What happens when your Savior is used as a vehicle to control and suppress you? Many people who are not white, especially in the U.S., commonly deal with the first and second questions today. In this image, artist Fred Carter depicts Jesus as active, doing something to help his people. He's sweating drops of blood. He's no longer pictured an ally to the oppressor, but instead an ally to the oppressed. Carter notes, there were many motivations I had in creating a black Jesus. A black Jesus would help me rid the sense of shame and self-hatred that was so prevalent in the African-American community over the last several centuries. Black Jesus may have appeared as white in imagery and symbolism, but he became a black Southerner through my work in the act of suffering, an oppressed slave, a victim of a crucifixion lynching, a poor migrant, a fellow sufferer on the front lines of civil rights battles. For some, it was not a movement to make Jesus literally black. It was a movement to make Jesus as someone that wasn't used against them to justify slavery. It was an attempt to make Jesus into someone who understood their plight by emphasizing their teachings and actions, the teachings and actions of Jesus that supported their belief. In this gallery of images from artist Janet McKenzie, we see her vision of diversity stemming from her work among women of color. From my larger collection of her paintings, I have juxtaposed images of Mary and Jesus across the top with images of Jesus from the trial to the resurrection across the bottom. McKenzie's Jesus of the People, which is the title of this image, was selected winner of the National Catholic Reporters Competition for a new image of Jesus at the time of the turn of the millennium. McKenzie's interpretation of Jesus pays homage to two groups often excluded from such imagery, African Americans and women. This Jesus is not pure masculine, so to speak, but has also shrouded characteristics that remind us that Jesus died for male and female, for black and for white. In the words of the judge, this is a haunting image of a peasant Jesus, dark, thick-lipped, looking out on us with his ineffable dignity, with sadness but with confidence. Over his white robe, he draws the darkness of our lack of love, holding it to himself, prepared to transform all sorrows if we will let him. In her book, The Stations of the Cross, McKenzie's rendering of the look of the face of Jesus as his trial says it all. Accused, judged, and condemned, Jesus stands totally undone, emotionally drained, more by the charges against him than any physical act of violence. Here she shows us what actually happens to a person who's publicly incriminated by a system that is clearly arrayed against him. It is as much a shocking time as it is a sad one. This moment, McKinsey notes, is all about the accusal of the innocent. We continue this theme. In this particular slide, artist Marilyn Filion notes this. Jesus himself, of course, was a death row inmate. And the title of this painting is Jesus on Death Row. And Jesus forgave a capital punishment prisoner with the words, "Amen, I say to you this day, you shall be with me in paradise." All these things impacted this portrait of Robert Edward Williams, whom she notes, "I accompanied to his death in Nebraska's electric chair on December 2nd, 1997. He was 61 years old. 21 years earlier, under the influence of drugs and alcohol, filled with rage and self-loathing, Robert went on a rampage, killing three women and raping two of them. Horrible crimes for which he was rightly convicted and then sentenced. By the time I got to know him, he was the most God-filled person I'd ever known. I painted this particular portrait of Robert because of the incredible, serene, and beautiful smile I found on his face the day after his execution. The mortician told me he had never seen such a smile on the face of a deceased person. And I remember Robert telling me that, well, he was not afraid to die. He knew being strapped into the chair and waiting for the switch to be pulled would be hard. So he said he was going to just keep saying, Lord, I'm coming home. Lord, I'm coming home. I guess it's exactly what he did, the artist says. Finally, we arrive at the crucifixion. This composite image shows the many ways this is depicted by artists, primarily here artists from Africa. The image I'm going to focus on in the crucifixion is a stained glass window. This window adorns Birmingham, Alabama's 16th Street Baptist Church. It commemorates the 1963 bombing of that church, which killed four little girls and became a catalyst leading to the passage of the Civil Rights Act. The bomb was hurled from a car by Ku Klux Klan members into the basement during the Sunday school hour. The tragedy of that Sunday produced outpourings of sympathy, concern, and financial contributions from all parts of the world, enough to repair and rebuild the church, which is now registered as a National Historic Landmark for the role it played in the civil rights movement in the United States. A special memorial gift, a large stained glass window of the image of a black crucified Christ, was created by a Welsh artist, John Petz, and given by the people of Wales. In this window, Christ is rejecting injustice with one hand, even as he extends forgiveness with the other. Let's put it together in a visual montage, accompanied by reggae music from the album Reggae Praise, a unique blend of music originating in the 1960s in Jamaica, and a precursor to many styles of contemporary black music, including black gospel music. As I said, this is a Reggae Praise song, and I felt this is appropriate music to see a collage of images of Christ. And it appears, there we go. Thank you, Ken.
Set our feet on solid ground. We must remember who
Now, how do you see Jesus? I hope you imagine him differently than you did before watching these wonderful images from artists, U.S., global, European, Latin American. A frame of reference for us and the opportunity to ask ourselves the question, just who is the Jesus that I worship? And what does he have to say to me and to those around me in this day and this age? And I will invite Chaplain Greg Waybright to come up and lead us in a benediction.
Thank you so much, Dean Moreau. And I'm so glad that we have a few of our graduate students here at Barrows, and many others hopefully will come on other Wednesdays, and those who worship with us remotely. I'm so thankful to be able to be a part of this with you today. Thank you, Dean Moreau. It's made me think of when God is finished with his work, we'll be together with people from every tribe, language, and nation, each one of us complete in Christ, each one of us, the Bible says, conformed to the image of his son. What will that be like? It will be marvelous, and maybe we'll be singing reggae. I think a Christ-centered benediction is right for today, so let us pray. So now, may our dying Savior's love, may our risen Savior's power, may our ascended Savior's prayer, and may our returning Savior's glory be so real to each and every one of us that it directs our lives until your work is complete and we are conformed to the image of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So now go in his peace.